Hi, Liz, how are you doing?
Hi there. Can you see my slides?
Yes. Did you need to test anything out before we introduce you?
Can you just tell me if you see them moving?
Oh, yes. When you click through them just a second ago, I saw everything moving perfectly.
Okay. Yep. No, that's fine.
Perfect. All right. I'm actually going to stop your sharing real fast just to share ours.
Okay.
All right. I hope everyone in person as well as on Zoom got a chance to stretch your legs and walk and at least leave the computer screen for a little bit as we continue on with our next wonderful presenter of today. So I'm Dr. Matt Zajic. I blame the students for everything today and how successful it has been so far and all of the speakers. I'm just helping the logistical side. All of the praise goes to them completely. So just saying that. And they've done a wonderful, wonderful job in all of this. But it's my pleasure to welcome Dr. Liz Pellicano, giving her a talk on ethical issues in researching neurodevelopmental conditions. Professor Pellicano has long been committed to transforming autism science so that it more accurately reflects everyday autistic life. She is currently professor of autism research at University College London, having recently also been a professor in Australia. Previously, she was also a professor of autism and autism education and director of the Center for Research in Autism Education at UCL Institute of Education. Her most recent research, funded by a future fellowship from the Australian Research Council, identifies ways to bridge the gap between lab and life and open up research to greater involvement of autistic people themselves with the aim of generating scientific discoveries that bring real benefits to autistic people and their families. And with that, I pass it over to you, Dr. Pellicano.
Thank you so much, Matt. Hang on one second, everyone. I'll try sharing again. Yes, we're sharing. Thank you so much, Matt, and to Julia and to everyone for inviting me to speak. Hello from London. I wish I could be with you in person because this is a fabulous set of speakers you have today. It's really exciting. I'm very privileged to talk about a topic that is very close to my own heart and affects so many people so deeply. Autism, as you well know, is one form of neurodivergence and is likely to affect you in some way too. So if you're not autistic yourself, you're very likely to know of someone who is autistic, whether that be your son or daughter, your neighbor, your cousin, your friend, or your colleague. So it's vitally important that we all know autism. The problem is that we don't. And I'm going to argue today that autism science, as it has conventionally been conducted, is part of the problem. Before I begin, I just want to say something really quickly about the language we use to talk about autism and autistic people, very contested issue, particularly at the moment. So the terminology that's usually used in research labs and journal articles, in hospitals, clinics, schools, and even in the press, is so-called person-first language, so calling someone a person with autism, so describing what a person has, not what a person is. But many disabled people have argued vehemently against the use of person-first language, instead preferring disability-first or identity-first language, such as he or she or they is an autistic person. And as you can see from this quote here, Jim Sinclair, an amazing autistic activist, describes why. So he says, autism isn't something a person has or a shell that a person is trapped inside. There's no normal child hidden behind the autism. Autism is a way of being. It's pervasive. It colors every experience, every sensation, perception, thought, emotion, and encounter, every aspect of existence. It's not possible to separate the autism from the person. And if it were possible, the person you'd have left would not be the same person you started with. That is, autistic people can never and should never be separated from their autism, both in life and in language. So throughout this talk and my work more broadly, I use identity first language, so autistic person, to respect the preferences of autistic people, especially my friends and colleagues. And I encourage you to think about the way that you talk about autistic people and why, and how you might want to talk about them in the future. So that was an aside. now onto my actual talk. And I'm going to go right back to where this all started for me. So it was then as a 19-year-old, long time ago, that I found myself working one afternoon every week with a beautiful little four-year-old boy who had a diagnosis of autism and his family. And each of those afternoons, we'd sit together at a wooden kitchen table in their house in a suburb on the edge of Perth, Western Australia. And slowly, bit by bit, I'd try to help him with his language. He only had a couple of words that he wasn't really putting together at that time. And I'd also help him like with his motor skills. So we'd throw balls and things like that. But those interactions changed my life. I was totally inspired by him and his mum and his dad and his sister. They had some really trying times, but they taught me a lot about support, about resilience, about empathy, and about the everyday realities of autism. And working with this family really spurred my interest and desire to become a scientist so that I could grasp what autism is and work out how people who are autistic or who live with those who are autistic can lead the best lives possible. And studying autism back in the late 1990s was exciting, intoxicating even. There seemed to be an explosion of, you know, theoretical insights and empirical work. And autism research seemed to be really blossoming as a discipline. Now, this, of course, could have just been my youthful enthusiasm, but it turns out that it wasn't just me experiencing this. So billions of dollars worldwide were indeed being spent at that point in time on autism research. It was a massive investment that culminated in 2006 when President George W. Bush signed the Combating Autism Act, which appropriated $950 million to autism research over a five-year period and provided grant programs for states to develop autism screening, early diagnosis, and intervention programs for children. In the UK, there was a similar increase in investment, nothing like the amount in the US, but nevertheless, there was a boost. And there was also a similar boost in Australia. So in short, there's been a lot of money targeted towards autism research. And just to give you a good sense of this, these data come from the Interagency Autism Coordinating Committee in the US, which my team contributed to the analysis of. This shows that in 2016 alone, there were more than 1,500 autism-related research projects totaling almost $400 million in Australia, Canada, the UK, and the US. Obviously, the US contributing the bulk of that funding. And there's been an enormous explosion, an exponential surge in publications in autism research as a result. And this surge far surpasses the growth in other fervent areas. So in this figure, you can see on the vertical axis, the number of publications. These are peer-reviewed publications. And on the bottom axis is year. So I hope you can see the pink line. The pink line goes sharply up. Publications on ADHD is the purple line, which is kind of still, there's a lot of growth there, but not nowhere near the growth on autism research publications. And the red line that you can see is specific language impairment or developmental language disorder. So there's, something's going on with autism research in particular. There's a lot of money going into autism research and consequently a lot of papers or outputs. But despite this hugely encouraging trend, the fruits of this research are still not being felt anywhere like directly enough by the broader autism and autistic communities. In short, we've done all of this work, but where has it got us? It hasn't changed lives. In fact, the life chances of millions of autistic people remain extraordinarily bleak. Autistic people experience substantial economic inequalities. Despite all of their talents and dedication, only a minority of autistic people enjoy full-time paid employment. More in some sort of paid work, but this is, you know, lower than people from other disability groups. And the minority of autistic adults who are employed are all too often in posts that are deemed unsuitable, either not consistent with their skill set and abilities, or for which they are just overqualified. And these inequalities also extend further. Research tells us that autistic adults are far less likely than non-autistic people to live independently, to have friends and more intimate relationships. Many also have co-occurring difficulties with their physical and mental health, which can be really debilitating and require, you know, substantial ongoing support. And most disturbingly, recent evidence suggests that autistic people suffer from premature death. Autistic people die on average 16 years earlier than non-autistic people and are 9 times more likely to die of suicide. None of us should be satisfied with facts like these. And it's not at all surprising that autism science is beginning to be called out as a result. Of course, scientific failures alone are not to blame, but increasingly, autistic people themselves are suggesting that the massive public investment in autism science demands a greater return. At the moment, they're simply not seeing any of the sorts of benefits that one would hope to see. This, of course, is part of a broader phenomenon. So in 2018, an editorial in one of the world's biggest journals, Nature, insisted that too much research done in the name of society fails to be of direct use to society. And as the Nature editorial continued, this is in part because other people, you know, policymakers, politicians, business leaders, don't take enough notice of the findings of science. But it's also a result of fundamental problems with some of the science itself. And in the rest of this talk, I will suggest that the ways in which autism science is conventionally conducted, and especially the methods it deploys, contributes to these less than desired outcomes and the declining public faith in autism science. I'll also suggest some ways to fix it. So I am, of course, not alone in this view. And as the Nature editorial suggests, the problems go far broader than autism science alone. So across health and medical sciences in recent years, leading scholars have been grappling with this question of why massive investment in science has failed to have the kinds of returns that broader society has a right to expect. And this article from The Lancet surveyed a number of possibilities. So these included things like, you know, the so-called reproducibility crisis, which suggests that even highly cited experiments aren't even replicable. Another thing they said was, you know, there's a limited accessibility of the research. So, you know, research isn't really even available to key decision makers and other stakeholders outside the scientific community, as is suggested by advocates of the open science movement. They also kind of posed, you know, whether the designs and methods deployed by scientists, often for good experimental reasons, have actually also generated problems of their own. And it's this last one, the one about research design and methods, that my thinking is focusing on. So let me put it bluntly, my suggestion is that autism science isn't enabling us to make the kinds of breakthroughs we need as a society because the methods we are currently deploying do not enable scientific endeavor to map onto people's everyday experiences. In other words, there's too big a gap between lab and life. And consequently, we don't know what we need to know about autism and autistic people. Let me explain this. So, you know, basic autism science, especially in the fields of psychology or cognitive science, cognitive neuroscience, has focused predominantly on studying autistic people within the lab. So carefully controlled, simplified settings where you can manipulate variables and discover causal relationships between one factor and another. And this established experimental method is autism scientist bread and butter. And there are really good reasons for this approach, it's been enormously fruitful to the study of human cognition. But there is an obvious problem too. This almost exclusive reliance on lab-based work has resulted in paradigms that are simple, contrived, and artificial, and thus limit the applicability of findings to the more complex situations that people experience in everyday life. That is, there's been a failure of lab-based work to map on to real-life settings. The findings lack what we call external validity. They fail a test of generalizability. This is a problem by itself, for research outside autism science. But it's an even bigger problem in autism science as a result of some fundamental features of being autistic. And that is that autistic people struggle in some situations more than in others. Their performance on tasks, that is, shifts depending on the context in which those tasks take place, far more than non-autistic people. So in my previous work, my colleague, Professor Dave Burr, and I have suggested that, you know, autistic people perceive the world in a fundamentally different way because they rely more on kind of incoming sensory input and maybe less on prior knowledge or knowledge that's accrued with experience. And as such, one of the key differences between autistic and non-autistic people might lie in the way that they process information in situations when levels of uncertainty are high. So autistic people rely much less on their prior knowledge in these situations in particular. So the argument goes, we should be less likely to uncover the ways that autistic people experience the world in lab-based settings, in those settings that are actually very controlled circumstances, not ones in which uncertainty is high. So differences should occur when uncertainty mounts, particularly in less controlled real-world settings. So my view is that autism research is therefore disproportionately disadvantaged by its over-reliance on controlled lab-based research, all of which could lead to fundamental misunderstandings of autism itself. I'm going to give you two examples of this mismatch between lab and life from my own work to show you why we really need to change the way that we do autism science to fully know autism and autistic people. So my first example relates to visual search. So there's been a lot of studies that have argued that autistic people show a strong propensity for being able to find things hidden in larger arrays. And these images on the slide come from classic visual search paradigms, psychological paradigms, in which the participant must locate a target. So on the top one, it's a yellow sphere amongst an array of distractors in more kind of in feature search or more difficult conjunction search. Now, it's true that autistic people are significantly better. They outperform non-autistic people on these tasks. So they have superior visual search abilities when they are tested in these kinds of controlled tabletop computerized or computer-based conditions. And this lab-based evidence has been used to support a major theoretical account of autism, so Simon Baron Cohen's systemizing account. And this theory says that autistic people have strong preferences to understand rule-based systems and thus be better at the kinds of real-world tasks that rely on such systems. This is a big claim with many potential implications. Yet the research on which it's been based has almost exclusively relied on paradigms designed for the computer or the tabletop, which are, of course, well-controlled and presumed to represent the state of cognitive processes beyond the controlled test situation, but nevertheless fail to map or tap into kind of or model abilities in the larger scale context that is typical of everyday life. So a few years ago, some colleagues and I tested autistic children's ability to search in a physical large-scale space. And we called this a foraging task. We tried to make it, you know, as close to the computer-based visual search task as we could, while still being closer to more true-to-life context. And this was our experimental setup. So we had 16 potential target locations, which were all lit green. And the child was told, you know, to begin by pressing the orange button nearby and then find the hidden red target as quickly as they could by pressing the switch at each green location. And critically, we probabilistically manipulated the blocks so that on 80% of trials, the target was present in one side of the room, which we called the rich side of space, which I can, you can kind of see in that yellow oval part of the display. And this experimental setup allowed us to test key claims of systemizing theory, but in a setting that approximated real life. So systemizing theory states that autistic people should be expert in recognizing the statistical regularities of stimuli within a system to extract the kind of if-then probability rules that govern the system and to use these rules repeatedly to predict the system's future behavior. So given these claims, we expected that autistic children would be better at large-scale visual search than non-autistic children. And we tested explicitly whether autistic children were expert at inferring that probability rule, whether they searched in an optimal or more efficient way, and whether individual autistic children were more systematic in their search, just as the theory predicted. Our results, however, showed that such well-established reports of superior visual search in lab-based settings did not translate to autistic children's search in more true-to-life contexts. So this animation here shows the search path by one, this is a neurotypical child on in our foraging room. And as you can see, they carry out their search via the shortest path, kind of pressing almost all the intervening buttons. I'll just move and show you. So this animation shows one of our autistic children, and his search is a little less systematic. So although he starts on the wrong side of space, he skips loads of intervening buttons, essentially making his search much less efficient because he would have to go back and kind of and press those buttons. And these are just two examples, of course. But for the group as a whole, autistic children were on average less systematic in their search strategies, contrary to the prevailing theory of systemizing, and exactly the opposite of what the conventional lab-based work had shown. Although this kind of shocked, I guess, the scientific defenders of systemizing theory, none of it really came as a surprise to people who actually lived with autistic people who were autistic themselves. In fact, these reports had actually mapped on to what parents had told us about their children. So these children's reports, parents also reported problems with everyday memory or memory within the context of everyday life. And specifically, they endorsed these two items that you can see significantly more than the parents of non-autistic children did. So they said that their children, you know, were more likely to forget where things are normally kept or looked for them in the wrong place. And they often got lost or turned in the wrong direction or on a journey or in a building, you know, when they'd been once or twice before. So difficulties with search and navigation were therefore not unique to our foraging room. And the old kind of lab-based work seemed to be misrepresenting what was going on in real life. So that was my first example. My second example comes from the field of executive function. I'm sure I don't necessarily need to define executive function for you, but essentially it's an umbrella term that includes those skills largely mediated by the prefrontal cortex, which are necessary for goal-directed behaviors, especially in kind of new circumstances. And anecdotal evidence has often suggested that autistic people have executive difficulties, and some have proposed that these problems might be linked in particular to the presence of restricted and repetitive behaviors and, you know, problems managing everyday routines. Yet, despite decades of research on executive functioning in autistic children, young people, adults, and hundreds of published papers, the existing scientific literature has almost nothing conclusive to say. Instead, it remains contradictory and confusing, with, according to a recent meta-analysis, group differences of only moderate effect. And such effects are a far cry from the large effect sizes that are often reported on questionnaire measures of real-world executive functioning and the everyday kind of planning and flexibility difficulties that are reported by autistic people and their parents in our own work. So why is there such a disparity between how autistic people and their families report their lives and the view of the established science? Once again, it's because experimental investigations of executive functioning in autistic people have heavily relied on structured behavioral paradigms designed for the computer or tabletop to kind of really try and target specific components of executive function, just like this one here. So the one you can see on your screen is the so-called Tower of London task. So people are given a pegboard with red, black, and white beads, all set out in a particular configuration, so the start state, and they're asked to move those beads from the start state to this to a new configuration, the end state, in the minimum number of moves. So better performance on this task reflects better planning ability. Such tasks, however, have been argued to lack representativeness. So that's the correspondence between the task that you see on the screen and, you know, what how executive function unfolds in real life settings. They're also being argued to lack generalizability. So that's the degree to which performance on a task like this predicts problems in real life settings. In my own work, and I've worked with autistic children and young people and adults who can pass these tasks with ease, yet they really struggle doing tasks that recruit executive function in everyday life, like, you know, going to the local shops or finding their way around a new town, or even doing, you know, domestic chores. You know, these tasks simply aren't measuring what we want them to measure in real life. Those kinds of, you know, really functional behaviors that are critical to achieving autonomy in adulthood. We therefore need to develop a new approach that bridges that gap between lab and life, one that is less focused on abstracted lab-based experiments and more focused on the everyday realities of autistic people. So what might that look like? So I've given you one example already in the form of a foraging task, where we were able to kind of keep that experimental control, but at least extend it to a context that, you know, more approximates that real life setting. And the same is true of executive function. So my former PhD student, Logan Kenny, and I administered a more kind of ecologically valid executive function task to autistic people. Young people. And basically we wanted a task over which we had experimental control, but would approximate, you know, a more real life everyday activity that might tax one's executive function. You know, and simple though it sounds, the results, you know, are generally profound. And in fact, you can see the results of the task because it was filmed, or a version of the task at least, was filmed for a TV documentary in the UK called Are You Autistic? And I'm going to play a bit of a clip from the, if the video works, that is, from the documentary. And as you will see, we worked with a wonderful group of autistic young people, including the two presenters of the show, to examine how executive function works in a kind of true to life setting, in contrast to traditional lab-based experiments. So let's see if we can just watch this clip. Oh, let's see if I can do it. Otherwise, I'll talk you through it.
Most people, when they think autism, think routine, strict timetables, maybe doing the same thing at the same time every day. And it's true that some autistic people do love routine, but we're not the only ones. In fact, most people in Britain don't like change. A recent survey even found 90% of Brits often follow the same routine every single day, and the majority actively avoid a change to their routines. Don't worry, it doesn't make you a little bit autistic. For us, it's not just that we don't like change, it's that our brains are wired differently, so sometimes change can be really difficult to process. I hate change. Hate it. It's just too much for it to... You just can't have change. It throws you out completely. Even if the light's changed, or if a person's changed, or if even someone's changed their hair, it's like, no, don't do this to me.
Things like planning, working memory, and flexibility to change are controlled mainly in the frontal lobe of the brain. It's not fully understood why, but it's thought different wiring in this part of the brain and how it connects to other parts means that some autistic people won't process change like the rest of you.
That's where our next scientific test comes in. Because JP and Joe have never had an official diagnosis of autism, our experts want to see how they cope with an unexpected change of plan. Overseeing the testing is Professor Liz Pellicano of UCL Institute of Education and her colleague, Lorcan Kenny.
So today we're going to test something called executive function, which is basically the way that the brain processes kind of complex tasks, breaks it down and makes it manageable and so that you can get things done.
Professor Liz wants to see how that translates to the real world, so is keen to take her research out of the lab and into everyday settings, like a takeaway kitchen. First up is Joe.
You need to prepare takeaway lunches for 5 customers.
The test involves invented customers ringing in 5 different packed lunch orders, and then Joe has 10 minutes to make them all, but not before a surprise change is introduced.
Okay, off you go.
So what exactly are you as a scientist looking out for, Liz?
We're looking to see how they prepare themselves, what kind of plan they work up and then put in place. We're looking to see how they can multitask, hold things in your mind and kind of work with them, and also kind of shift flexibly from one thing to the next.
Jo's been quick to formulate a plan and is already bagging up finished lunches. But how will she cope when 3 of the 5 orders are unexpectedly changed?
Hello.
Right, okay. Okay,
so the customer
could have a cheese sandwich.
Mm-hmm. But it's better to toast it, have a cheese sandwich. Okay. Bye. No, she doesn't stress. Jo is struggling with those changes, isn't she? So deviating from her plan.
And time is up. Well done. How'd you find that?
Awful. That was really horrible. It was really horrible. I think if I was at home, I probably would have thrown something or screamed because I was so transfixed on what I'd already written down. And that's what I was expected to do. So when the change came, I couldn't really focus on the change because I already had it in my mind what I was doing before.
So that, I hope, gives you an idea of, not that we're all going to go out and do research with documentaries, but to give you a sense of, like, you know how we might test executive functioning in more real life settings. And that is now the essence of my work. So, I'm developing a kind of host of new experiments, which are as rigorous and as traditional lab-based ones on which our knowledge of autism is based, but have far greater representativeness and hopefully generalizability, because that's how we're going to bridge this gap between lab and life. And I'm sure you too will have some reflections and suggestions on how we might do this. But before I close, there's one more crucial component that I haven't yet talked about, but I'm already certain we need, and that is autistic input in the design of these new approaches. So ever since the idea of autism was first, developed in the 1940s or before that, autism science has typically been designed and conducted without any significant input from autistic people. And I think that's contributed towards research agendas and research methods that rarely relate to the the realities of autistic people. And when I say input, I mean beyond input as kind of passive participants or subjects in research, because they've certainly done that, but input into the decision-making processes around research, in the design and implementation of the research, and in the analysis and interpretation of the findings. And as we know from my own work, that lack of involvement results in real feelings of frustration. So in a focus group that I ran, you know, more than 10 years ago now, one autistic person, you know, in the focus group rather skeptically asked me, you know, whatever I say, is it really going to influence anyone? And in responding to this problem, I've been drawing upon innovations in participatory, co-designed, co-produced research that I know already has a long history outside of autism. So many of you will have heard about studies co-designed with HIV patients and First Nations communities. And it's also an approach having a sweeping effects on more basic science, including agriculture and environmental science, where it's widely reported that processes which draw on the practical wisdom of non-scientists can have a dramatic effect on both the research agenda, so what gets researched, and on the ability of research to discover otherwise hidden explanatory factors. And we've already begun to see the impact of science being conducted by or in partnership with autistic people themselves. There are lots of amazing autistic scientists and researchers who have had an astonishing impact on the field in recent years by challenging some of the hidden and often prejudicial assumptions that have been rife in the academy for too long. I'm going to give you one more example from my own work of how this kind of approach might help us to understand autism and autistic people better. And what I'm about to share comes from a study my colleagues and I worked on during the COVID pandemic. And in it, we, so a wonderful team of autistic and non-autistic researchers, explored the everyday experiences of autistic people, parents of autistic children, and even young people, young autistic people, during the COVID pandemic. And we compared them, their views and experiences, with conventional views about autism generated from existing autism science. So conventional autism science expected that autistic people, perhaps more than anyone, would have coped best with the lockdown that was most governments' response to the COVID-19 pandemic. After all, you know, the very word autism comes from the Greek autos, or isolated self. And as one autistic adult described sarcastically to me in an interview, she said, you know, according to the theories, we self-isolate. We do that all our lives. So autistic people are ready for lockdown. Well, to discover whether that view and others like it were right or not, we spoke to 142 autistic people, parents of autistic children, and even young autistic people themselves about what their day-to-day lives were like during the pandemic and the impact that it had on their lives. This is from the first 2 months of the pandemic in 2020. And we had so much data, almost 7,000 minutes of interviews with people via Zoom, phone, email, or live chat. And critically, our participatory approach, that is the working together of autistic and non-autistic researchers, had a huge influence on our work in terms of the size and depth of the sample. So the community reach, I can tell you now that if I'd done this without the connections of my autistic researchers and colleagues, it would have taken me months to recruit this number of people for this sort of interview-based study. Our co-production approach also influenced the kinds of questions that we asked and the way in which we asked those questions, ensuring that our interviews were really respectful and supportive of our autistic participants who were often having a very difficult time. And finally, The participatory approach also influenced, our analysis and in the interpretation of the findings, drawing attention to things that would have otherwise been missed. So what did we find? So far from welcoming the isolation that came from lockdown, the vast majority of autistic people that we spoke to deeply missed social contact. So you can see some quotes there. So one autistic adult said, I don't need a lot of human contact, but I've been really needing a lot more contact from my friends than I perhaps usually would. Another young person said, you know, I prefer hanging out with him, her friend, in person as opposed to just over text. So I haven't really been talking to him as much as I do, but still somewhat. I've really missed that. And our participants' desire for social contact went further than their established social circles and quality friendships. Not having much, or in some cases, any social contact during the COVID-19 lockdown period of 2020 made them long for it. So this is from one autistic woman that I interviewed. She said, you know, I didn't realize how important that incidental human contact was to me. It was so incidental that it never really registered on my radar until it was gone. The paying for the petrol at the service station, as much as it shits me, because I work with an assistance dog, right? So everywhere I go, I've got this giant, white, majestic beast next to me. And so the soundtrack of my life is, oh my God, it's a dog. It's a beautiful dog. What kind is he? How old is he? What does he do? And like, that drives me bananas most of the time. And I've actually found myself even missing that. This also had real and important implications for all aspects of life. So when it came down to school or therapy, for example, our participants also noted that the online connections simply weren't enough. So one young person said, you know, summed it up by saying, just the idea of talking over Zoom and stuff is not the same as a real person. And the apparent unease in these online interactions had dire consequences with regard to access to services and with continuity to care. So often, rather than, you know, using telehealth or telemedicine, people felt that therapeutic sessions have to be face-to-face. I need that personal interaction. And ultimately, this meant that many of our participants stopped receiving therapeutic services during the COVID-19 pandemic, at least in that first two, three month period. And this final quote is from a 17-year-old who said, you know, I stopped all of my psychological appointments, which was a bad call, because if it's an online version of a medical appointment of any sort, I just dread it. And the dread is often worse than not doing the appointment. I spoke to her, she was in acute psychiatric care at the time. And through this example, we can see, you know, what a terrible effect getting the science wrong can have on the realities of autistic lives. Just contrast our findings with conventional science and conventional practice, with the assumption that autistic people don't want friends or social contact, that they prefer social isolation. Conventional science still cleaves to a view of autistic asociality derived from age-old experiments and theories. And that means conventional practice has followed that science to the detriment of actual autistic experience, presuming that this is what autistic people want or will be willing to put up with, when in fact, exactly the opposite is the case. Thankfully, it doesn't have to carry on like this. We can do autism science in a different kind of way, attentive to real life and open to the perspectives of autistic people themselves. And if we do that, we'll have a far better chance of avoiding those problems. All of the investment will be worth it after all, and we'll have a new way of knowing autism. Thank you very much.
Thank you. So I see we have a couple questions in the chat, so I'll just pull them up and I'll read one aloud for you. So what is your advice for researchers who want to increase community-based research with autistic individuals?
Yeah, that's a great question. That's another talk, in fact. But co-production or participatory research is all about relationships. So it's all about developing relationships with autistic people and, you know, and maintaining them just as you would for any other collaborator. So the autistic people that I work with, I very much see them as my collaborators. So it is about kind of taking the time to get to know people, to get to know their perspectives. It's about developing trust, listening to and learning from one another. And I guess being really open to other perspectives. I think that's particularly important. The other thing to be mindful, I think, when developing these kinds of partnerships is that they are about relationships, but they're also about power. So it is about sharing power in decision making. Typically it's researchers up here who are doing all those making all those decisions. But in participatory research, we make decisions with community members. So my autistic colleagues and collaborators. And we share those decisions, we make them together. And I think that's kind of often difficult for academics or researchers to kind of let go of. It's quite nice having power in those goals or being, you know, you have research expertise, so you kind of want to use it. But it's important to kind of recognize that, you know, autistic people have a different kind of expertise. It's experiential expertise of being autistic. And that's the kind of it's bringing that lived experience and research experience together. And it's that sharing of power in those relationships. But it is all about relationships. So it's about kind of developing you're developing those relationships. Yeah.
For sure. Thank you. And we have another question. Well, first I'm just going to say, does anyone in person want to ask a question?
Yes. One more question.
Okay. You can just press, I think you can press the mic there and it should work.
Thank you very much, Professor. I'm curious if you could comment a little bit on how research into understanding the physiological differences between autistic people and neurotypical people, because I've seen like research about using mice models, autistic mice models, which I'm not sure how that effective that is. So I'm curious your thoughts on what needs to be done for that kind of research.
Do you mean in terms of making it map onto real life or be more or what the point of it is?
Okay. How exactly, what would be a better way to conduct that kind of research to understand those physiological differences?
Yeah, that's a very good question. I mean, there's a lot of tension, I think, in the field now on kind of genetic-based research, so biobanks, and kind of animal model research using autistic mice or zebrafish or whatever the animal model is. We're currently doing some research, and the research that we did over 10 years ago on people's experiences of research, we're following that up with a new group of people now. So we're asking them about, you know, how do they feel about more biological research? And it's actually not the case that autistic people don't want that biological research to take place. Not everybody, obviously, but it's not that they don't want it to take place necessarily, because we just don't know about the biology of autistic people. And so, but they want it to be done in a way that is respectful. And that I guess that they can have a say in as well. So my suggestion would be, you know, if you're embarking on that kind of research, would be to talk to autistic people and kind of, you know, see how it fits in with, there are lots of autistic people who have biological, you know, their own kind of theory, but biological perspectives and theories and would be really willing. Like one of my postdocs is an autistic neuroscientist who used to work with zebrafish. So, and, you know, we have these discussions all the time, and her, and she's, you know, we try to, it is a kind of bringing those perspectives together to do research that is potentially more meaningful. I mean, but also is more respectful of the community.
Great. Well, thank you so much for being with us today, Dr. Pellicano. We're just going to have a quick break then, and then we'll move on to the next speaker.
Yeah, thank you so much for having me, and enjoy the rest. I've got to go and take my daughter to a piano lesson, so I can't see the rest of your presentation. But yeah, thank you for listening, and do get in touch if you have any questions over email. I'm more than happy to field those. But yeah, enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you so much.
Thank you.